Good morning. We're going to ask that if you could come in and take your seats, please. Everyone in the foyer can come in and be seated. This will be the wake period for Brother Michael. I'm going to ask that you would please come in and take your seats. Listen, I know that this young brother's departure will be a void for some of us. But I was speaking with his cousin, and as I understand it, he is in fact a believer. And so for me, that's good news. And listen, today it's going to hurt for a while. And I know there's going to be a void. But I want you to know that memories are redeemable. Whatever good times you've had with this brother, on the time that you're feeling down, you can cash that memory in, and the Lord will give you comfort. This is going to be our wait period. We do have a presentation, and I'm going to ask that they come. Not only was Brother Michael a believer, but he was a member of the Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. And so right now, the brothers from that fraternity are going to come in their own way and give a presentation on behalf of their brother. We ask that they would come now.
This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother. This man is an alpha. This man's a brother of A5A. This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother. This man is an alpha. This man's a brother of A5A. This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother. This man is an alpha. This man's a brother of A5A. This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother. This man is an alpha. This man's a brother of
Good morning. The men of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, will you greet them, please? This morning, we're here to perform the Omega Service. The Omega Service is a prayer time where we welcome our brother as he enters the chapter of our sweet rest we call Omega. At this time, if there are any other members of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated in the audience, please feel free to come up here and join us. The Omega Service for Brother Peel.
I am the resurrection and the life, said the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live.
O Master Eternal, give to each of us the deep consciousness of thy presence, that the spirit of fraternity may so direct our thoughts, guide and control our hearts and lives, that we may become, through thee, servants of all mankind. Amen. Amen.
In our
are thou.
thy glory, thy honor and renown.
And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. In the beginning of the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and him was the life and light of men. Then spoke Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He said that, follow me shall not walk in the darkness, but shall have the light of life. For God who commanded the light to shine out of the darkness hath shone in our hearts to give the light of knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Ye are the light of the world. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is and which was and which is to come, the Almighty.
Amen. Amen. O Father of life and giver of light, look with favor upon thy creatures here assembled,
and grant us thy blessings.
O thou who hast led man through the ages of his existence, upon the earth of thy Spirit,
grant us thy continued guidance.
Thou who dost generate love and goodness in hearts, and the desire of fellowship, one with the other, in life's living,
increase thy Spirit in us.
Thou who hast called our brother from his task to reward of noble thought and deed,
deepen our memory of him.
Thou who art the light of the new heaven, the new earth, the new Jerusalem, grant the final resting place with thee to all whom thou hast called, and finally ourselves. Amen.
Good morning.
My name is Derek Robert. I bring you guys a greeting from the Iota Pi chapter of Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. We would like to send our deepest condolences to the family and friends of our dear brother, Mikey Peel. Mikey was initiated November 22nd, 2014, along with 15 other young men. Mikey was the co-anchor, number 15 of his ship, SS 16 May, 16 militants aggressively defending Egypt. And in Alpha Land, he was known as Fresh Prince. In our chapter, Mikey was able to serve on the exec board on two separate occasions. In the 2015-16 school year, he was the treasurer. In the 2016-17 school year, he was our chapter president. Mikey served on the MPAC exec board at SIUE. He was a sponsor for our Miss Black and Gold pageant, a member of the Black Student Union, Collegium 100, and other clubs and organizations on campus. Mikey had a very genuine personality and was willing to help and lend a helping hand to anybody in need. When it was time to plan events or parties, Mikey always came up with the big ideas to try and do any and everything to make our events successful. Mikey was always about the money. Typically for our parties, we would have shifts on who was at the door to collect the money. Now mind you, we didn't just let anybody do this. The chapter heads not only trust you, but ensure that you wouldn't let anybody in for free or at a discounted rate. We knew that Mikey would hold it down with no worries and may even make some extra money for us. He was so good with words, he had such a high level of confidence that he could talk to people into giving us extra money even if they didn't want to. To know Mikey was to love him. I had the esteemed pleasure of being Mikey's pledge box. For those who don't know what that means on titles, I had the pleasure of taking Mikey under my wing and guiding him through his journey to Alpha and beyond. It wasn't just a typical pro fight and Neo relationship that was truly my little brother. Mikey would come to my house, open my fridge, take whatever he wanted, lounge around the house any way, shape, or form, and yell to the top of his lungs with no remorse to anybody else. That laugh and that charm would light up a room regardless of any situation. As we all know, Mikey could be really stubborn. When he thought he was right, no matter what you said or how much you would try to convince that man, he never changed his mind. Without any doubt, I would love to hear his laugh and his voice when I have one more argument with him again. To Mikey's family, you have our chapter's deepest condolences during this time, as Mikey was a part of our chapter too. Whatever we can do for you at any time, please let us know. To his friends, remember all the positive and loving memories that you guys shared together. To his ships and other brothers of A5A, remember Invictus. I said that to say this. We know Mikey, we all love Mikey, but we know that he would not want us with our heads down. Let's continue Mikey's legacy for greatness. Remember the good times and happy memories. I love you, Sonny. We love you, bro. We got you, we got the family. Until next time, long live Hill. Thank you.
Resolution of respect for Brother Mikey Hill. According to his tender mercy, God, who is infinite in his wisdom, has seen fit to move from our midst our beloved brother in Christ by means of death on October 17, 2019. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he will make your path straight. Whereas the passing of our beloved brother has left us with a broken heart, we acknowledge and accept the will of God. We know our hearts bleed with sorrow, but we are comforted by knowing God will not put more on us than we can bear. Whereas, on behalf of the Iota Pi Chapter of Alpha Phi Fraternity Incorporated, and I, we send our condolences to the family of Brother Mikey Peel. Mikey is a Fall 2014 initiative of our chapter. And when one man is down, we are all down. But we work together to build one another up. During the initiation process, we learned a poem called Don't Quit by Clinton Howard. The poem goes as, when things go wrong, as they sometimes do, when the road to tragedy seems all uphill, when the funds are low and the debts are high, when you want to weep, but you have to sigh, when care is pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't you quit. With that being said, we want to let the family and friends of Brother Mikey Peel know that times will be hard for, but never give up and don't quit. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace the family because all of us have a common bond that will connect us for the rest of our lives. We cannot replace Brother Mikey Peel, but we will attempt to demonstrate his love for you. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be given to the family and a copy be kept in the Iota Pi Chapter of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated Archive. To the family, we know your loss is deep and your sorrow is great. But we want you to know that we share that sorrow. But more importantly, we recognize that this loss is heaven's gain. Humbly submitted on the second day of November 2019, the Iota Pi Chapter of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated.
November 2nd, 2019, to the brothers of Illinois District Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated, pause to pay tribute to the memory of our beloved brother, Michael J. Peel. Whereas Brother Michael J. Peel was initiated into the beloved brotherhood of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated on November 22nd, 2014, Iota Pi Chapter. Whereas Brother Michael J. Peel continued his service of brotherhood through serving as Iota Pi's chapter president, 2016-2017, chapter treasurer, chairman of the finance committee, 2015-2016, and this black and gold sponsor, 2016. Whereas, Brother Michael J. Peel, life made an impressive and indelible impact on a myriad of people locally and statewide. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Illinois District of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated share your bereavement. Well, let us also remember the words of Jesus the Christ, who assured us, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believeth in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die." St. John 11:25. The Illinois District of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated cannot replace Brother Michael J. Peel, but we will attempt to improve our lives as demonstrated by the examples of our dearly beloved brother. Be it further resolved that the brothers of the Illinois District of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated bathe you in prayers that God's grace of lovely mercy, comfort, and faith finds an abiding place in your heart during this moment. We commend you to our blessed Lord, who can sustain you. Sympathetically submitted, myself, Franklin Stacy Jr., Illinois District Director, Montgomery D. Prophet II, Assistant Illinois District Director, Dr. L. Bernard Jakes, Illinois District Chaplain.
Alpha Brothers, gather around and make our praise resound of this brother whose labors now are crowned. His good deeds heaven bless, commend them through each test to Omega, our chapter of sweet rest. Farewell, dear brother, transcendent art thou, thy spirit shall dwell with us now. Cherish thy memory, thy good name will revere. To thy glory, thy honor, brother dear.
The grace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit, brother. And now, may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your heads and minds in the knowledge and love of God and his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen. In our
Spirit of eternity, rule our hearts, guide our thoughts, and control become through thee, service of all. Amen.
This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother.
This man is an alpha. This man's brother of a five.
Let's see.
This man is an alpha. This man is an alpha brother.
This man is an alpha.
This man's brother of a five.
This man is an alpha.
This man is an alpha brother.
This man is an alpha.
This man's a brother of a five.
Now is Christ risen from the dead, had become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. But some men will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, and another of birds. There are also celestial bodies, and bodies terrestrial. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown a natural body, and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. The first man is of the earth, earthly. The second man is the Lord from heaven. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthy, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. In love. Amen. We're going to get started in about 10 minutes officially with the homegoing service of our brother Mikey. Amen.
Keeping in the back. Have you from the brain? Come on, I'm out as awesome. Thank you. Lord, Opportunities Program at Southern Illinois University, Edwardsville, where Mikey Peel was one of my students. Like you all, I loved Mikey Peel. He was one of my favorites. Mikey was one of the world's stars. He was determined and willing to step up and step out for his dreams. He was willing to live his story, willing to go out on a limb for what he believed in, and he always did it with that beautiful smile, always willing to help someone else, lifting as he climbed. Mikey Peel was a star. He was a lovable and loving soul, and he always greeted me with a warm hug. There are many times in life where we fail and circumstances will try to keep us down. There are so many people in the world just allowing life to take them under, allowing their gifts to go to waste, to go untouched. That was not who Mikey Peel was. Mikey Peel was determined and unstoppable. Mikey was determined to never give up on his dreams, goals, and his visions. He worked hard at it every day, never accepting no for an answer. An example, there's a rule in my office that the students are not allowed to use the office printer. There are designated printers for the students, but Mikey preferred to use the printer in my office because it was free. And he could talk to me and he could talk to my staff while printing. I would tell the secretary to tell him no, he couldn't print, because I could never tell him no. Well, she couldn't either. So Mikey was the only student in the whole university who could print for free in the SOAR office. Mikey would leave school in the middle of the week to go anywhere in the country to promote one of his events. Las Vegas or wherever, who does that? What college student does that? I would fuss about him leaving and he would just smile and say, "I'll be back, Dr. Pete." There was this one time when the students were supposed to go to Ohio on a field trip. It was a mandatory trip. And the day before they were supposed to leave, Mikey comes to my office on crutches. He said he had hurt his foot and he would not be able to make the trip to Ohio as he couldn't sit on the bus for that long ride. Of course, I was sympathetic and I told him I understood. But the real story was that Mikey had a huge conflict. He had already bought tickets to the 2 Chainz concert that weekend, and he had no intention of missing it. Imagine my surprise when I'm on Facebook and there is Mikey streaming from the 2 Chainz concert. I called him and busted him out. I said, "Mikey, you're gonna have to write a 3-page paper for missing that field trip." With that butter wouldn't melt in his mouth voice, he replied, "No problem, Dr. P," because he had already done what he wanted to do. The following Monday, he brought me a 3-page paper just like it was some flowers. I loved Mikey Peel. Mikey knew no one ever said life would be perfect or easy. He believed that when you fall, you have no choice but to get back up. He knew that there was a gift inside of him that needed to be seen, that needed to be heard, that needed to be delivered. He lived larger at 24 years old than many people, 3 times his age. I admired his commitment to enjoying the life that God gave him. I was blessed to know him. We know that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Mikey came from good stock. His parents gave him permission to be great, permission to shine, permission to be exactly what God desired for him to be, permission to be unstoppable, permission to live his dream. God gave Mikey Peel a mother that knew how to love. And did she love Mikey? But she didn't just love Mikey. She loved young people, period. She came to my office and gave me a box of gift cards, several hundred dollars worth of gift cards. They were $25 gasoline cards and $25 Target cards and restaurant cards. And she said, she asked me to distribute them to students that had a need. It has been such a joy in my life to know Mikey Peel. He was a light in this world, and he still is. His life was far too short, but it made a huge impact. I will never forget.
Thank you. See how good and how how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. My connection with the deceased is his daddy. Remember, we had won a championship, and the only way that we won was to be together. I just talked to him. I told him, man, he still doesn't have a jump shot. My name is Coach Reverend Donald Lee Williams, known as son as Hat Man. We still play ball, and I'm here to just encourage this great family. And may I, Pastor, I'm Emmanuel Baptist Church, Dr. L.K. Curry Emeritus is my pastor, and Rogers W. Jackson. Will all the basketball players stand from the basketball group? Tree is tree here. But anyway, we love you, my Peel family. The only reason we won to step together. And they said there's power in unity. You young black men, you millennials, stick together. That's where the power is. God bless you. God give you grace, his peace, and his strength during the difficult times. We love you. Can I get a hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. My soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. To Mike Peel and Marlene Peel and the entire family, I have been on my face for these last 2 weeks praying for this family. If you look around this room and see all the people that are 24 years old have touched in 24 years, little Mikey Peel was just so awesome. He's an awesome young man. And I just have one quick story and I'm gonna take my seat. Mikey was getting ready to go to prom. And Mike and Marlene, you know, and when people can respect and have you talking to another child's life, it's so awesome. And Mikey wanted to wear a red suit to prom. And they called me. I said, Mikey, you can't wear a red suit to prom. I said, you been going to prom looking like Bozo without the makeup. So what happened was, I said, Mikey, you can get another suit made. And you can wear that forever and forever. That's why I have this red tie and this red pocket square on. Mikey was just such a class act. He took after Marlene and he took after my best friend, Mike Peel. Me and Mike, Kathy Russell, we go back about 40 years. And I just thank each and every one of you for coming out and to supporting this family and continue to pray for them after this is over. God bless you and thank you. Amen.
Where, O death, is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Felix Simpkins, and on behalf of the Simpkins family and School District 162, Mike and Marlene, we know we're here with you. We've been knowing you for a long time. And our hearts go out to you. We love you, and we're there for you. God bless you.
How y'all doing? My name is Devin Huggins. I'm Mike Peel. His ship is 12, and I'm 15. But I just came up here to say this, Mikey, without really speaking a lot of words, like, really did do a lot to my character. Like, if it was one thing, Mikey showed me how to use life. Like, I don't know how we could be in class the same time and then 4 or 6 hours later, he in Toronto. I'm like, you was just on my snap a little while ago. But at the same time, like, He the reason why I'm able to do these type of things is just like, even like right now, coming here now, I was in Vegas, came here, going back to Vegas, doing all this stuff. He the person that showed me like, bro, I have to do stuff with this life. It's not about me being 40 and trying to do this stuff. That's why it's so hard to see my brother like this, because for some reason, he always know how to pack a room, no matter what he do. And if I knew Mikey, he's at Heaven's Gate charging to get in. So, I just want to tell y'all, like, man, just keep trying to use this life like Mikey would. Like, keep doing things that's gonna make y'all have fun, because, man, Mikey was fun, bro. That's all I want to remember is Mikey having fun. Like, that's all I got to say.
How y'all doing? My name is Dondre. Some of y'all know me, some of y'all don't. First of all, I want to thank God for blessing us with Mikey's life. And I don't know how I'm going to keep this at 2 minutes. I'm going to try. But knowing Mikey, he wouldn't keep it at 2 minutes either. So I'm going to say what I got to say. I met Mikey. I moved to the Birds when I was like 5, so I had to meet Mikey at like 7 or 8. I met him at a summer camp called JCC. And we had so much fun at JCC. And I just remember Brian, Kaylon, Mikey, Daniel. And it was just a good time. And Mikey was just so warm. And he always, he was a selfless person. You know, like Mikey like always gave himself to people. And he always knew how to have fun. And he always was a light. And I don't know, just being able to really come up with Mikey, like, I thank Mrs. Peel and Mr. Peel for always opening the doors for us, because every time it was his birthday was 7 days before mine, so every time it was his birthday, we'd be at you know, the Peel's residence, we'd be at the Peel's crib, and it was just like, those were the funnest times, you know, it was the funnest times. And then, you know, come high school, we still rocking together, and I mean, we had some crazy times in high school. Like, we did a whole bunch of stuff, you know what I'm saying? Like, some stuff that we, you know, some people know, like, nobody laughing. Some stuff we probably shouldn't have done, but everything that we've done made us, you know what I'm saying, who we are today. And it's like, I really, really pray and ask God. I'm like, God, why? Why? But God told me, Mikey's purpose was fulfilled. We look at all the people that are in here right now, and we all have been touched by Mikey Peel. Mikey touched all of us, and we don't have anything bad we can say about Mikey Peel, because Mikey Peel was strong, he was a leader, he was creative, he was gifted, and he had a whole bunch of stuff that he wanted to do. And he did pretty much more than all of us. Like, he traveled everywhere, you know what I'm saying? Like, he did a lot of great things, and he planted seeds inside of us. And I just want to share a quick story. Just how faithful and how loyal he is. I remember one time we drove to Toronto, the first time we went to Toronto. Mikey drove his car and I drove my car. And, you know, Mikey never smoked, you know what I'm saying? So for some reason, when we were driving, my car was a smoking car, right? Sorry. But so Ryan was in Mikey's car. It was Ryan, Teddy, I believe. So we driving to Toronto, Mike leading, I'm in the back. So Mikey and them go first. So I don't know what happened, but they got in very smooth. They got in real smooth. I think because Ryan was in the passenger seat with his glasses on, so they looked like it was good, right? So, but they stopped us. They stopped us and pulled us over to the side. And so they wanted to search our whip. And we didn't have no loud, you know what I'm saying? We didn't have no loud. And they wanted to search our whip. And I thought Mikey already went, but Mikey had pulled over and waited for us, you know what I'm saying? Because that's how loyal Mikey is. And one last quick story. You know, I want to really hit this home. So, thank you so much again for opening the doors so much. Mikey threw a party. Mikey threw a party. A lot of y'all was there, some of y'all wasn't there. You know what I'm saying? So, but when Mikey threw this party, it wasn't the first party that Mikey threw this, okay? It wasn't the first party, but it was the last party at the house. And I talked to Mrs. Peel about it, like, recently, because she never heard my perspective of the story. And y'all didn't hear my perspective of the story. So, he was able to have that party. Like, Mrs. Peel gave permission to the party. I remember Mrs. Peel told me, Mikey, how many people going to be at this party? You know how Mikey is. How many people?
Like 100.
The minister was like, okay, this is 2016 now, going into New Year's of 2017. This is a week before the fashion show, a couple days before the fashion show. You know, Mikey helped out with both the fashion shows, I'm so sad. But we're gonna have to make a tribute for him this year. But anyway, so we have this party. And the party started getting out of hand pretty quickly, right? So I remember so vividly, I don't know if Cindy's here, but Cindy was here. And I remember somebody broke, okay, so you guys have those very expensive African sculptures. Okay, so it was like very like, the party was getting out of hand and I knew in my mind, Mrs. Field is coming home tomorrow. So I saw somebody, oh, they're sitting there. You go. I saw somebody break a bottle of Patron and they cut their hand open and they were bleeding. And then they went to the hospital. I'm like, oh no. So I go up to Mikey, I'm like, Mikey, bro, this party getting out of hand. And he looked at me in my eyes, he was very serious. You know, Mikey getting a little loose sometimes, he was having some business upstairs. Not like that, but it was crazy. And he looked at me, he told me, he's like, bro, I need you to take control of this party, bro. I'm like, all right, bro. But mind you, I'm not in my right state of mind. So I'm trying to tell people, hey, y'all need to chill out, you know what I'm saying? Y'all tweaking, you know what I'm saying? I'm not trying to be a party pooper, you know what I'm saying? But like, mud started sparking up in the basement. We weren't supposed to be sparking up in the garage. You know what I'm saying? So I'm like, okay, we gotta really get this under control. Long story short, the police end up coming. The police come to the door. 30 minutes later, so they looking at me like I'm tweaking, but like they see the police came, I'm like, that's what I was trying to tell y'all, but I was tweaking. So I was like looking for K-Line, because I know K-Line Lord my calendar, you help me. Anyway, so the police came, and we know our rights, you know what I'm saying? Police is at the door. And in my mind, I'm thinking about Project X, because I know me and Mikey always talk about Project X, and we always talk about like all the things we wanted to do. And that was like a Project X party. We didn't let the police in. Somehow they got in, I don't know. They went in, it was so many people in the crib, people going out the back door and stuff like that. Long story short. Afterwards, I remember I called Mikey the next day, because we had rehearsal the next day. I'm like, Mikey, are you good? He's like, yeah. I'm like, what? He's like, yeah, I'm good. And that's how I knew God was real. Because we were not all of us was 21, but you know, there was stuff in there, but he was good. So, man, all I gotta say that to say Mikey was loyal, man. And so, all we can do, I love you guys so much. I love you, Mr. Field. I love you, Mr. Field. And you know what I'm saying? Let's just keep this same thing. You know what I'm saying? And this is the whole point of the story. Mikey could always bring people together. You know what I'm saying? That's why we all here today. It's some people I haven't talked to in years. And it's some people in here today, y'all might have something to get somebody else. Squash that. For what? It's not worth it. So I gotta go. So
my hearts go out to you all. I will continue to pray for you for the rest of my life. My name is Derek Ratliff. I just want to share a story. I had an opportunity to have a second son, and that second son was Mikey. I had an opportunity to coach the kids. I coached their basketball team from sixth grade to eighth grade. And we were talking earlier, in life you have two types of people, right? You have followers, you have leaders, you have winners, and you have losers. And Mikey was truly a leader. So I want to share a story with you. Michael and I served as coaches for our kids, and I don't want to get too choked up. But so the whole deal was we wanted to make sure all the kids got equal playing time, right? But Mikey was the first one at practice. He was the first one ready for the games. He would always sit right next to me. And he was like a coach on the floor as well. So whenever we were losing, Mikey would always find a way to slide right next to me. He would start off at the end, but right when we got to about first minute or two into the fourth quarter, he would always be next to me. And I would always say, Mikey, how'd you end up down here? He would always say, Mr. Ratliff, if you need me, let me know. I'm going to be over the game. So really, the moral of the story is Mike truly was a leader, always was just a bubbly, positive young man. And I think it's all been said here. So God be with you all. Marlene and Michael, my heart goes out to you all. And I truly, truly mean that I'll be praying for you for the rest of my life. Okay? Thank you.
I didn't want to sleep, but Mikey told me he'd haunt me if I didn't, so. We've been best friends for almost 10 years. We actually met in kindergarten, but he didn't remember it. And in middle school, we both ended up in Illinois school. In eighth grade, we sat next to each other in Ms. Tillman's class, and I didn't study for a test one day. So Mikey was taking his test, and he looked over and saw that mine was blank. And he tapped on me. Rewind, I gotta tell y'all, I couldn't stand him. He used to call me Twig Arms. I used to tell him his lips like the bottom of a balloon. So that was how, like, it all started. So when he tapped on me to let me cheat off of him, I was like, okay. Like, thank you. And as I was sliding the test back over, we got caught. And when we got caught, he took the blank. And I tried to, like, I was like, nah, he said, nah, you good. Oh, yeah. And that was kind of like how our friendship was. We ended up going to Central junior year of high school, and he lived like 5 minutes away, so every day I would go pick him up, and he made me late every single day because Mikey was a diva. And I remember Miss Pill was like, who is this driving for free? And after that, we just got really close, and their home became my second home, to the point that one day I rung the doorbell, and Miss Hill came very angrily, like, why are you ringing my doorbell? And I was like, I don't know what I did wrong. She said, girl, you don't walk in this house. And from that point, we became family. And just, you know, another story to show his character. I was in the hospital 2 years ago, and I called him, and while we were on the phone, he was packing his bags, and he drove up to Chicago, and wouldn't leave until I got out. And I couldn't have like outside food or anything, and you know, it was like my whole family, we're all sitting there, and I was just complaining about how I wanted some tacos. So all of a sudden, Mikey and my cousin disappeared, and I already know Mikey, so I'm like, where did he just go? But 20 minutes later, he comes back, he sits down, like, unzips the zipper on my knee. So I'm like, okay, I unzip it, and it was some tacos. And then I'm like, I can't eat these. He's like, I got you. He goes into the hall, and he distracts all the nurses so I can sneak into the bathroom to go eat tacos. That's just kind of how our friendship was. You know, we really, looked out for each other, and as with any friendship that long, you're going to have your ups and downs. And one thing about Mikey was he never held a grudge. Even when we had our like moments where we weren't really the closest, we still made sure we checked in. We still made sure, you know, praying for you, sent words of encouragement. And Mikey was like that, everybody. Mikey never held a grudge, no matter who did anything. He had such a forgiving heart, and my mom always joked that his personality was too big for his body. It was too big to be in a small body. And he had a big body, a big personality, and an even bigger heart. I'm gonna really miss him.
My name is Joseph Ratliff. I had the pleasure of meeting Michael James Pill in first grade in the class of Ms. Reuter. Just like anyone else,
I've had my ups and downs with Mikey. I've gotten in a lot of trouble with Mikey. But I was very conflicted coming up here this morning. This week has just been a big struggle just because I didn't believe it in the beginning. And I still don't believe it now. But I wanted to start off, Mr. and Mrs. Peel, thank you for giving me the brother I never knew I needed. A funny story about me and Mikey, just to ease the mood, is so when we were our freshman year of high school, we had gotten the best job ever. We were servers at the Flossmont Country Club. And honestly, it was just the most flexible job, boshing ever. I know y'all remember as well. We were all in there together. But basically, one day, you know, Mikey being my brother since first grade, he was just running a little bit late. And I knew this, and I knew he was in the parking lot. You know, Mikey on his way, he's in the parking lot. Let me go ahead and just badge him in, not really thinking. And also, it was my first job, not really knowing, you know, the rules and things like that. So obviously, you know, later down the line, we were fired. we were let go that week. But, and I felt so bad because I was like, man, I shouldn't have did that. Like, I just did it just because I knew that was my brother. And I went to him and I literally said, Mikey, I'm so sorry, bro. Like, I honestly, you didn't even ask me to do that. I just did it. And the thing he replied to me was, he said, bro, don't worry about it. He said, don't worry about it, bro. I would have did the same thing for you. But you know there's a country club in Olympia Fields. And that's just the type of person Mikey was. He knew everybody, he loved everybody. He was literally a trendsetter in his own right. And I'll never forget that man to the day I die. And one last thing is, Mikey never forgot anyone's birthday. Man. It didn't matter where he was, what country he was in, what state he was in, I could always look forward to a text from Mikey on my birthday. And so I will always love him for that. And just the people that he's connected me with. So thank you so much for taking me in, the Bill family. I really love you guys so much. And I'll be there for you whenever you need me.
Floyd. I knew Mikey since kindergarten. Mikey and I have been very close ever since kindergarten. He was the first friend I ever had. He was the first friend that I ever lost. But everyone that knows Mikey knew that Mikey lived every day to the fullest. He celebrated every day of life. He wouldn't be forgotten. Rest in peace.
Good morning. My name is Jasmine Weaver. I'm Natalie Bohm. And we had the pleasure of being friends with Mikey for about a decade. And we just wanted to share with you all so much of the loving times we had with him and experiences that we had with him. Everyone got up here and spoke about how Mikey lived life fully and how he wanted to help people. He spent a lot of time talking about his dreams and his purpose, and he really just wanted to inspire people as much as he can and pour into people as much as he can. And something me and Nat has been talking a lot about is how grateful we were to have that experience. So concentrated, just to share something small, I've been going over text messages recently and just was reminded by how much Mikey really just anything that I was getting ready to do, wanted to make sure I did it my best. Something as small as I was having a game night a few weeks ago, and he was running a little bit late, and he was texting me, telling me all the different ways that I could like make the game night the best, and I could be the best hostess. And he really applied that type of love and that type of commitment to any situation we were in. He was so dedicated to making sure that everyone had everything that they needed, making sure that everyone's dreams could be fulfilled. If there was any resources that anybody needed, he was a bank for resources. So I just want to stand up here and remind everyone and encourage you all to show that same type of love and dedication to the people in your life, to just kind of honor him in that way by showing up fully, by giving 100%, by loving the people around you as much as you can. So yeah, Nat has a beautiful story she's going to share with you all.
okay, I really didn't want to get up here either, but me and Mikey also have talked about a lot of stuff. The beginning of the year, most people know Nipsey died, so we were just like talking about death and things like that, and he told me that if I didn't get up here, he would kill me, so here I am. So I recently moved back to Chicago. Me and Mikey have been very close since the first day of high school. The week before he left, we were both like going through some things, and we were like, okay, let's try to figure out what we can do. Let's get out of the house or whatever. So he took me to his little thinking spot. I'm sure he's taken a few of you all there before in Tinley Park. But we went there and we were just talking about everything, and it was just like a weird aura around us, and we were looking out at everything, and there were just black butterflies everywhere, like black butterflies everywhere that you see. And I had never seen black butterflies before, and I was like, no, this is weird, this is crazy, and I think everything has meaning. So I looked it up while we were out there. I'm like, okay, Mikey, like, whatever, I'm gonna look it up. So I looked it up, and it said that death was coming. That's what it meant. And so I looked at Mikey, and we were just, like, he was still talking. Like, I just kind of like brushed it off. And I was just looking at him, and he was just looking at me, and he was just telling me about basically all the plans that he had, all the plans that he had for everybody in here, everything that he wanted. And so I never even mentioned it to him. Like, I never said what it meant. I didn't think anything of it. So now, weeks later, coming back to it, thinking about the time we spent getting up to there, it just all ties in. He was preparing all of us, so I want everybody to just think about the last conversations that you've had with Mikey, the last things that he's told you, things that he wanted you to do, because Mikey was the kind of person that we all go to for advice, but we really knew what he was going to say. He was going to encourage you to do the right thing. He was going to encourage you to do what you wanted to do. So I just want everybody to take that and just think about him and think about what he would want in all of your coming actions. I also wanted to speak on the fact that, you know, everybody mentioned how positive and everything he was. And, you know, like, we all have times that we get down. So I just wanted to say I'm so grateful to have been a person for him to come to about not just the happy stuff, but the sad stuff too, about all of you all in the audience, different things that I've heard. I'm just so grateful that he trusted me with that and that I was able to be there for him in that way. So, yes, I love him. We just wanted to say we're so proud of you, Mikey. We're going to make sure that your legacy is carried out to the fullest. And Mr. and Mrs. Peel, we're here for you and we're praying for you and all of Mikey's loved ones.
My name is Diane Ames. I'm Mikey's cousin. I remember when Mikey was born. I remember when Marlon carried him. I knew Mikey had greatness in him because the pregnancy that his mother went through was extreme. And I'm like, this kid, he's got something going on. And he did. You can tell by his life. Here I stand, 46 years old, and I haven't done half of the things Mikey has done. But I was extremely proud of my cousin. And I want to say to his mom and dad, thank you for giving me my cousin. I loved him so, and so did my son, Wendell Daniels. They were born in the same year. they were like brothers. They played basketball together, they went out together, they planned to take a trip. And I also told them that they still need to do that trip and make sure that they do it in remembrance of Mikey. During this week, I composed a little letter that I had written to him based off of a post that my cousin Julie Venture had posted on our family group meeting. And it goes like this. On the morning of October 18, 2019, after finding out the news about Mikey, our cousin Julie Belcher posted this on the family group chat, which warms my heart. And I truly wanted to share this with everyone on today. Mikey, think about the name. M stands for motivated. Mikey was a go-getter. It wasn't nothing that was going to stand in his way for him to excel and accomplish his goals. Intelligent, Mikey was wise beyond his years. Kind is a big word for him because that is our family motto. Mikey would always give a helping hand with a big bright smile to help brighten someone's day. Enthusiastic, he was always full of energy. Didn't know where it came from, but wish I could have bottled it and sold it. He was always doing something, no matter what time, no matter what day, or whatever he had going on. And why? For youthful. Which it kept him young at heart and a joy to be around. As you look around this room, you can see how many lives he touched and many more who weren't able to be here. These words describe Mikey to a perfect T, and he would definitely be missed by all who were fortunate to know him. He had a zest for life that was out of this world and definitely contagious, and would have you pondering the thought of, wow, have I really lived my life to the fullest, and what should I do to ensure that I start doing so? I can personally say that I did exactly that due to my cousin's major accomplishment of becoming a member of Alpha Phi Alpha Fraternity Incorporated in 2014. That inspired me, moved me greatly. It moved me to fulfill my promise that I made to my aunt, Charlene Drake, many years ago by becoming a member of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated in April of 2018. That was my proudest moment, and knowing that my cousin inspired me to do so just brought me to tears. I want to close by saying thank you, Mikey, for the fine example that you have set for all of us to follow to accomplish our life's goals and to always strive to live our best life in honor of you. Love you, kid. Gonna miss that smile.
How are we doing today? My name is Elijah. I'm Mikey's younger cousin. Mikey was never like a cousin to me. He was more like a brother. I always looked up to him. He always had everything before anybody had it. He was just like a big brother. Like, I remember I used to come to his house. He used to tell me like, no, I don't wear those with that. He used to tell me not to wear stuff or tell me what to wear. One story that my family all know is I used to spend the night over Mikey's house every chance I could get. We used to watch movies late at night, and Marlene would always let us order pizzas and stuff. So we was watching Scooby-Doo, and this was like when they first came out with the animated movie. And I was like young, I was scared. I was scared of that movie. And Mikey made me watch that movie. Like, he paused it every time I walked away, like, he made me watch it. Like, I remember that night I was calling my dad. It was like 1 or 2 in the morning. I'm crying, like, Dad, come get me. Because he has a big house and like all these African like sculptures. I just want to remember Mikey in the right way. He lived his life to the fullest. He never took no as an answer. He always just strived to do his best in everything and everything, anything. So that's it.
Oh boy. The memories of a life well lived. I don't usually say this about the younger generation, but I really wish I could have met him. I really do. It seems to me that he knew how to live his life. And a suggestion to every young person in this room, and not so young, live your life. Live it for God, and live your life to the fullest. This, to me, you should see yourselves. It's packed here. This brother impacted a lot of people. A lot of people. And it seems to me that his parents had a lot to do with that. So listen, I just want to give you a hand. Now again, I never really said it about the younger generation. I'm just going to tell you how I am. This brother seems to me he was just a man. Amazing young brother. All right, we're gonna have, is Sister Tina Davis here? Tina, amen. She's gonna come and bless us with a song.
Stand before you and thank you so much to my family, for asking me to say a few words. Before we get right into the Word of God, let me acknowledge the pastor of this house, to the leadership of the Progressive Baptist Church, certainly unto Reverend Hawkins, to Reverend Dr. Eric Leek, pastor of Martin Temple and Amy Zion Church, Reverend Dr. Jody Miles, pastor of Greater Walk of Amy Zion Church, and to all of the ministers of every rank in this room. Beloved, I'd like to get right to the Word of God. It's in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. A few short verses. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, starting at verse 11. Reads like this: and make it your ambition to lead a quiet life. You should mind your own business and work with your hands, just as we told you, so that your daily life may win the respect of outsiders, and so that you will not be dependent on anybody. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and he rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. For the short time that is mine for hours to share, I'd like to share upon this topic, looking up to Mikey. Looking up to Mikey. Won't you join me in a word of prayer? Consecrate me now to thy service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up to steadfast hope, and my will let it be lost in thine. Lord, send comfort. Lord, send strength. But, O God, send a word even today. In Christ's name, amen. Looking up to Mikey. Tragedies are a commonplace, especially when it seems to happen to those we love. And beloved, I can only imagine the thoughts going through your head right now. I know we are in four walls of a church, but there are many of you who are sitting in these pews and are mad with God. Some are distraught. Some are confused. Some are disappointed with God on how this could be. Some are even filled with anger. So much so that if we could actually see God right now, and if he were to stand in front of us, we'd give him a piece of our mind. We'd give him a few choice words, a few colorful words, wave our finger, wave our fist right in his face and tell God he made a mistake. We feel cheated, hoodwinked, because of all of this. And I know that even in the midst of all of this, we have, some of us have more of a distrust with God. Because we are left with the question, God, why him? Why our friend? Why our nephew? Why our son? And why our family? Well, beloved, I don't mount this pulpit to profess that I have all of the answers. And I certainly don't mount this pulpit to give you cliches that only tickle your ear but do nothing for the heart. Because like many of you, quite frankly, when I heard the news, I was quite confused and I began to question God myself. And while God is able to handle all of our hard questions, while God is big enough to handle all of our emotions, our pain, our sorrow, and even our anger at him, because we keep asking the question, why, God, you took him so young? And I contend that every now and again, although, we must turn our why God so young into a wow God, he did so much. Because while he was 24 years old, this brother had the best and made the best out of his own life. He traveled the world
multiple times. He was adventurous. He was loving. He was compassionate. He was cultured and creative. He was a giver. He was passionate. He was confident. He was a trendsetter. He was funny. He was a dreamer. And he even brightened people's day by just his very presence. I mean, I dare to say that Mikey did more in his 24 years of living than most people will do in their whole entire lifetime. Developed and matured so his so much so that his character and his being than an average person would do. And I know it hurts. I know it is painful. But sometimes in your pain, you've got to thank God for the life that he did live and that he lived among us. I don't mean he just existed. I don't mean he just took up space. But the brother had a purpose and a reason for being here. And as I peruse his life, I contend that Mikey was put on this earth for each and every one of us in this church today. That when God created each and every one of us in the forming of his hand and breathed life into every one of us and put us on this earth, that God knew we would need a Mikey in our lives. That God stepped into the future and saw that we needed a laugh every now and again. So he dropped a Mikey in our life. God stepped into the future and knew that we would need some joy in our lives. And so God created a Mikey just for us. God knew that we would need some love in our life. And so God gifted us with a lover named Mikey. God knew that we would need to be shown forgiveness and taught forgiveness by somebody. And so God gifted us a brother named Mikey. God knew that we would need somebody to help mediate and improve the situation. And so God gave us a gift named Mikey. And can I get a witness in here that if we were to sum up the totality of Michael J. Peel's life, we could say he was a gift that kept on giving. Selfless and full of surprises. Mikey was a gift. And my parents taught me way back then that whenever you receive a gift, the right thing to say is thank you. And so this is the right time to say thank you, God, for giving us a friend and a son and a cousin and a nephew and a brother. I remember Mikey. Every Labor Day, the young family gets together at one of the houses here in Chicago. And we enjoy each other's company. It's been an ongoing tradition and a bit ever since I was a kid. And I remember driving down from where I used to live in Grand Rapids, Michigan, all the way to this city, being excited to eat my great aunt's food and my great uncle's barbecue. And it was at this yearly event that I saw Mikey. Mikey was just 2 years older than I, but I always felt as though he was 10 years older than I because simply of his height. Here comes this 6 foot whatever towards me. And while I really never expressed it to him, I always looked up to Mikey. He was cool. He seemed to have it all together. And did I mention to you, he was also very tall. And as I thought about his life and heard what the family was telling me about him, and I realized that there are more reasons to look up to Mikey than simply his height. We can look up to Mikey because he was a prime example of our scripture and our text today. Can I take you to the Word of God? Paul in this text is writing to a church, reminding them of what they've been taught. And he simply tells them three things. To live a quiet life, mind your own business, and do your own job. And if the truth be told, these words, straight out of the Holy Writ, straight out of the Bible, need to be our new mottos in life. But many of us know that these biblical words weren't also just biblical words, but they also characterized the life of Mikey. And I believe even on a day like this, this is why we can look up to Mikey, because he was one who lived a quiet life. I don't mean he never didn't say anything, because the brother could debate and the brother could talk, but rather he lived a full life without necessarily bragging about it. Mikey explored the world, Amsterdam, Colombia, Greece, all across the United States and so many other places. He was an active member of the Alphas, involved in the 100 Black Men, part of protests with Ferguson, excelled in school, could make connections for just any and everybody, and gave so much of his time and his energy, and he easily could have, but the brother never really gloated about his life. And my brothers and sisters, we can all take a page from the book of Mikey today, that you don't need to show off to the world what you have and what you do all the time. Everybody doesn't need to know all about your business. There is no need to rub it in people's faces that you're the president of such and such, or you have such amount of money in your pocket, or you drive a certain car, or that you've been here or there. No need to show off yourself to make people like you. No need to stretch yourself to make people approve you. No need to treat the church aisle like it's a runway at a fashion show. But you want to live a quiet life. Because Mikey lived a quiet life. And if Mikey taught us anything today, is that you ought to live one like him. One that says, no, I don't need to have the approval of others. But God made me who I am and gave me the stuff I have just like everybody else. One that says I don't have to tell everybody my next move. Because what God has for me is simply just for them. It's for me. He lived a quiet life. Secondly, not only did Mikey live a quiet life, but he also lived a life that minded his own business. Mikey was one who was focused, one who knew what he wanted. So he did his work. He saved his money and put in his time until that which he desired was in the palm of his hand. He was passionate about his dreams and about his interests, and rarely was he distracted by the foolishness of others or the foolishness of life. And my brothers and sisters, many of us can take a page out of the life of Mikey that tells us that we ought to mind our own business. Sadly, many of us are focused on what other people are doing, and we neglect to mind our own business and our own work. Some of us are so concerned with what other people say and what other people think and being in competition with other people that we don't get the chance to live our own lives as Mikey did. And I know we like gossip. I know we like reality TV shows. I know we like the drama of other people's lives. But just like Mikey, we need to keep our focus. We need to stay in our lanes. And we need to keep our eyes on what we have to do in order to make it in this life. And if Mikey taught us anything, it is that life is too short to be up in everybody else's life that you miss out on your own. Was one that lived not for others, not for the applause or the thumbs up of those around him, but he lived for himself and did not worry about what others had to say. He minded his own business. Thirdly, and I'll take my seat, we look up to Mikey because he worked with his hands. Mikey was a hard worker. I mean, the brother worked hard in order to get what he wanted. Mikey was one that would rather work hard and grind instead of asking others for something. But in addition to that, he was also a giver, constantly giving of his time, his energy, his resources, and his love to others. And maybe each of us can take a page out of the life of Mikey this morning, that we cannot always live off others. And maybe we can take a page out of the life of Mikey this morning, that all of us have to work for that which we desire. That if you want something in this world, that yes, knowing the right people helps, that yes, having a foot in the door is cool, and yes, being financially endowed is great, but eventually you're going to have to work for what you want. Wishing it into existence, naming it and claiming it, blabbing it and blabbing it, and depending solely on others will only work for so long. For even the Bible tells us that faith without works is dead. And Mikey understood this, which is why the brother had a great work ethic. He sweated and put in a good day's work to obtain the things he desired. The fine clothes he wore, he worked for that. The travel that he made, he worked for that. The degree that he achieved, he worked for that. And if we don't learn anything from Mikey today, we ought to learn that anything worth having does not come easy, and it must be worked for. Well, let me take my seat right here. There is one more thing we can look up to Mikey for, and that is simply for his faith. It is my understanding that Mikey was making preparations to be baptized in December. Now, baptism is simply just the outward expression or the telling of the world the profession of your faith. That while Mikey quite didn't make it to the water you go down in really does nothing for you. But it is a symbol or representation of you being born again. The old preacher used to say that you can go down a dry devil and be raised up a wet devil. That while Mikey didn't quite make it to the water in December, we thank God that he made it to heaven in October. How do you know? I'm glad you asked. See, the fact that he wanted to be baptized was already a sign that he desired the Lord Jesus Christ in his heart. And Mikey realized that going all these places was great. Yes, living his best life was cool. Yes, doing his own thing was all right. But it meant nothing if it did not involve the Lord in his life. Somebody in this room ought to connect with that. And while he did not make it to the water, we thank God he made it to the heavens. And may I admonish each and every one of you under the sound of my voice that don't let another day pass without accepting the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Waiting till Sunday is not promised. Tomorrow is not promised. As a matter of fact, the rest of today is not promised to any of us. And so it is important for all of us to get to know the Master. Yes. Because life is full of ups and downs. Life is full of mountains and valleys. Life is full of being in a roller coaster ride. Life can be tough and difficult and knock you down to your feet. And so you need a Savior who did not promise that you wouldn't have trouble in this life, but did promise that all things will work together for the good of those who love Him. You need a Savior that did not promise that you wouldn't have enemies, and that you wouldn't have those who would try your last nerve and oppose you, but He did promise that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. You, my brother, you, my sister, need a Savior. One who did not promise that you wouldn't struggle sometimes, but did promise that He will supply all your needs according to His riches in glory. You need a Savior, my friend, that did not say that we wouldn't have some difficult situations to face, would not have some pressing times, but did say that we can do all things through Christ who gives us the strength. You need a Savior, my family, that did not promise that sometimes in this life you're going to want to feel like you want to give up and throw in the towel, but did promise that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, you need a savior. Did not tell us that we would not encounter death sometimes and sickness sometimes and tragedy sometimes, but he did promise that there we shall find rest for the weary. That one day, outside of this earthly house and tent, we shall find a resting place. A place that's described as streets paved with gold. A place that's described where we'll just be worshiping God morning, noon, and night. A place that's described where every day will be like Sunday. There is a place, my brothers and sisters, where God shall wipe away every tear from your eye. There is a place where the devil cannot tempt you no more. Sickness cannot get us no more. And trials and tribulations cannot trip us up anymore. And I contend that Mikey is right there in that place. He's in that place called heaven. And he's traded his Gucci and his Armani for a white robe and a crown. Where he's traded his love for exploring the world to now just exploring the love of God. And my brothers and sisters, this is why we can look up to Mikey. Because he's no longer here, but he's there with God. Let me close this thing. There is a story of an old man who had three sons. He was on his deathbed, called his three sons into the room. Moments before he closed his eyes and took his last breath, the three sons gathered around the bed and said, "Father, we want to remember you." So they said, "Give us your house. Give us something of sentiment that was important to you." The father said, "You don't need none of that." He said, "Get that picture of me from the wall." There was a picture of him in his former and younger days. And the three sons began to fight over the picture. "I want the picture. I want to remember Daddy. I want to put this in my house." So the father said, "Give me the picture, boys." And took the picture and ripped it into three. And he gave one piece to the youngest son, one piece to the middle son, and one piece to the older son. So they all looked at their pieces of their father and said, "Daddy, what are we supposed to do with these incomplete pictures of you?" And the father said unto the three sons, "The only way you're going to remember me, the best way to memorialize my life, the only way you're going to remember the good times and the funny times and the precious times we have together is if you come together and put the pieces together." And my brothers and sisters in this room, among every pew, even in the balcony and even those watching, there are many pieces of Mikey in this room. There's times where you knew him to be a giver. Some of you knew him to be a precious son. Some of you knew him to be a funny just nephew. Some of you knew him to be a great friend. Some of you knew him as loyal. And the only way you're going to remember Mikey in total is if you come together and remember him as one. Point being, you cannot go in this world alone. That you need your brother and your sister to your right and to your left in order to continue the legacy of Michael J. Peel. It's in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the precious Holy Ghost. Church of God, say amen. Amen.
That's the next one.
I'm going to ask the directors to come. I'm going to ask the pallbearers if they will come forward. Shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.